Welcome to the Mighty Podcast. I'm your host, Dave Johnson. We'll be talking about almost everything related to organ transplant. They say the harder rock and roll is to be. And from what I've seen, I believe them. Now the other may be barely breathing. But the harder rock and roll, harder rock and roll is to be. Yeah. Very quickly, want to, in this episode, talk about how to survive hospital stays on an ICU, because we're having to do that a lot. I more and more read on forums and in on Facebook pages, people trying to survive these long hospital stays. There's such a thing as ICU delirium, and it comes from being in this isolated environment where you're not having a lot of contact with the outside world. Every day is the same. The temperature is always the same. The clothes are the same. The people are the same. And you start to develop delirium. There are things you can do to prevent that, and there are things you can do just to that are, I think, good for your mental health, your emotional health, as well as your you know, physically. And so I want to kind of go through those and talk about some things that I did and how we survived that stay. Now, I talked in the last episode about this kid, Perry Jenkins, who had essentially moved into the hospital. He'd been living in the hospital for quite a while with an artificial heart. The week that I met him, I went down to his room, and it was crazy. He had the bed pushed against the wall. He had his Xbox hooked up to the X-ray monitor. His chair was in the middle of the room. He had stuff to, basically cook meals using this microwave, equipment that the nursing staff had got him for Christmas, 'cause he was there over Christmas. And he had gotten some things from Amazon. He had stocked his cabinets with all kinds of food, snack food and whatever else that he needed. He basically made himself comfortable there, which we don't think of doing that in a hospital room a lot. So I learned a lot from watching him and watching how he was coping with and surviving this long-term stay. And it came in handy. I ended up in a five-month stay, cumulatively 5 months in the hospital, waiting for a heart while I had my artificial heart. One of the things that my family was already doing when we moved in, when I was going in for 2 out of every 8 weeks to have the Swan's catheter put in. You guys, most of you know what that is. They would leave it in because they needed to give me meds. I was trying to accumulate time on the list. So I was just walking around this unit, ambulatory, cognizant, aware of what was going on, walking past rooms where people were on ECMO and people were intubated and in comas. And I was having to abide by the same rules as the people in those rooms. And my family was having to abide by those rooms, which is really odd. And I feel really strongly like there's coming a time soon where, because we have so many people now that are able to be awake and cognizant, but in an ICU situation. In other words, they're on LVADs, they're on dialysis, they're on assist devices, and they're waiting for an organ, but they've got to stay there on the ICU with all these patients who, for them, they're out, and there's no sense of the passage of time, but we're trying to bide our time there. And I feel like at some point, hospitals hopefully will start separating those kinds of units so that there's a different set of protocols for people who are waiting for an organ or in whatever situation where they're ambulatory, where they're able to get up, walk around, their families can visit, sit in the room. They can, you know, kind of have a little more control over their situation and their surroundings than the person who's hooked up to ECMO, laying in a bed and just unaware of what's going on around them. So I think to survive these stays, one of the things that was very important early on was to kind of accept the reality that this was going to be a long-term situation. In other words, these are the nurses and the doctors and the janitors and the physical therapists and the equipment assessment people and whatever else. These people that come into my room, I'm going to have a long-term relationship with them potentially. And it ended up being a 4-year relationship for the most part. It was really important early on to establish a good rapport with them. Now, I didn't always feel good. I was grumpy at times, but I tried to keep in mind, these are people that are going to be taking care of me ongoing. I want to store up as much goodwill with them now as I can, because there's going to come a point where I cannot do anything for myself and I'm going to be dependent on them. And there's going to be times if I'm in here long-term, consecutive, many consecutive days, weeks, months, that I'm going to need some things. I need to be able to do some things that maybe are a little unconventional and untraditional. And I'm going to need people on my side. I kind of learned that from Perry. He had stored up a lot of goodwill with his staff by doing things for himself as much as possible. When I was in heart failure and I was in, you know, in with these Swan's casts, two out of every 8 weeks, I started getting to know these people really well. So I started trying to, and it's just my nature to make friends with people, but I started really to try to think about what can I do for myself? In other words, I'm not ringing the bell every time I need a drink of water, you know? Can I somehow have water in my room that I can just get up and go get a glass of water when I need to? Well, there's a sink right there. Of course I can. But what about the ice, you know? So my mind started getting kind of on that track, and I realized, you know, I know where the linen thing is for the, you know, for the linens, and I need to change my bed sheets probably, you know, middle of the week, trying to stay clean. I've got this thing in my neck. So I just would go, and I didn't say anything to the nurses. I would just go get some sheet. I would put my stuff in the bio, can't, you know, waste thing. It's not waste, but the laundry thing that they had there, the bio laundry or whatever. I'd throw the old ones in there. I'd grab two new sheets. How hard is it to make a single bed in a hospital? I just had this thing in my neck that was hooked up to an IV pole. I wasn't in pain. It was uncomfortable, but I could make my own bed. I could get up and get my own water. You know, so not calling them every time you need the TV channel changed or every time your toe hurts, but trying to remember that right now, if you're not in an acute situation, you're just in there waiting. If there's anything you or your caregiver who's there with you can do for yourself, you should probably try to do it. It's not that the nurses are going to treat you any differently. They're going to treat you the same, hopefully, whether you are high maintenance or low maintenance. But there's going to become there's going to come a time when you are very, very high maintenance. And it's nice at that point to be able to say, hey, I know that it's past time to get a snack or whatever, like it's past 11. Do you think you could find something for me? Or, hey, tomorrow such and such is coming. And I know we're only supposed to have three people in the room, but I really, you know, they're all coming together. There's four of them. Is there a room we could go to somewhere? Could we go to the waiting room? Can a nurse accompany us to an outside space where we can have everybody together at the same time? They don't have to do those things, but it's nice to be able to ask those favors. Typically, if you're a difficult patient to deal with, nobody wants to go out of their way to do those things. Maybe they should, but they just don't. So I think it's a good idea to store up that goodwill. Think about it as a long-term thing. Think about long-term mentality. When I go into the hospital, I need these specific things every time. I had a bag that just stayed stocked with a book that I was reading. It had a cell phone charger. It had some snacks. Had backup meds in it. I don't want to tell you to break hospital protocols. You're supposed to turn in any meds that you have or don't bring them. But I'm going to say, especially for post-transplant patients, you've got to be on those meds every 12 hours. And if some disaster happens on the ICU that something happens on the way to the hospital, you don't ever want to be in a situation where you don't have your meds with you or you don't have access to them. Once you're admitted, then you're on a schedule and you're getting those meds every 12 hours. But that admission day can be a little dicey sometimes. We've had situations, and we were at a very good hospital, but we had situations where I was admitted, but because of other emergencies, urgent things going on the unit, or because of the time at which I was moved to a room, I would have been, you know, sometimes 3-4 hours behind getting those meds. So I don't like being at the mercy of anybody, including hospital staff, in terms of my immune suppression medications. I always, 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 no matter where I go, no matter what I do, I've got a day's worth of those. If it's a hospital, I tuck them in a pocket in a bag. I'll typically tell them they're there. I'm not going to use them. I just want to have them in case for some reason the things are running late and I don't get them on time. I know that I can take them on time. And again, I was able to do that and it wasn't a big deal because I had built up a relationship and a bit of a rapport and goodwill with the staff there. I think technically they're supposed to take them. So again, I don't want to tell you to break protocols. None of this is to break protocols, but it's to do what you can do to take control of your situation and not be just at the mercy of whatever's happening on an ICU, because there's a lot of people there that have a lot of needs. You need to take care of yourself as much as possible in that situation. So have a long-term mentality, have a bug out bag, make good relationships. I would also say that lethargy is an enemy on an ICU. This is where the delirium comes from a lot of time. If you're sitting watching Andy Griffith 24 hours a day, if you're sitting watching the 24-hour news cycle and just passively, you know, filling yourself up with this stuff, and you are not doing anything with your mind, if you're not engaged somehow, you are lethargic, you can develop delirium from that. You need to be mixing some things up. I think it's really important not to just sit and passively watch TV. I think it's important to be involved in something, whether it's video games, whether it's conversation online, reading a book, something that engages the mind so that you're not just sitting there like a sponge absorbing every terrible thing coming through the television. I look at lethargy as an enemy. And I don't want to say that to say that you need to be productive and doing something the whole time. Just be engaged. Have your mind engaged. It's the best preventative for that. I think also it's important, because the environment is so wrought with difficult situations. There's a lot of despair. There's a lot of anxiety. You've got families, you know, you're walking around the hallway and you've got somebody's dying in that room. Someone's coding in another room. You've got a family that's saying goodbye to their relative for the last time, or people hooked up to machines or comas. Nobody knows what's going to happen. And there's just a lot of anxiety and it's a difficult environment to be optimistic and positive in. I've got a friend named Hugh Hollowell. He's actually the husband of an HCM friend of ours who was transplanted right around the time that I was. She actually was very instrumental in helping me find good health care at the kind of beginning of my whole journey way back in the 90s. He's a Mennonite pastor, and he does a lot of work with the homeless population in Jackson, Mississippi, and LGBTQ, which you can imagine in Jackson, Mississippi. That's, you know, there's a lot of overlap between those two communities. And he said to me at one time, and I think he may have actually said it in a Facebook post, but I know I've had this conversation with him. He said, it's really important when you're in a situation that is dreary and depressing and there's a lot of ugliness, that you surround yourself with beauty, that you surround yourself with things that bring you comfort. And that was such a powerful thing for me to consider. He plants flowers. He has a garden that he works on because he enjoys that. He keeps paintings around that bring him joy. He's got books. Even if he's not reading them, he's got books around that bring him comfort and joy. He surrounds himself with things to remind himself of the beauty of life and the goodness of life. And I find that that is so important in hospital situations. If you need to have a picture of your grandkids there, if you need to have a favorite book nearby, I kept a CD. There's an album called The Black Parade by My Chemical Romance. Not a big fan of the band, but the album is just to me, it's a masterpiece. They deal with kind of the irony of life and death and hospital stays, and I don't really know what the story is behind it. But I found great, great comfort in that album early on in my diagnosis. And I didn't even listen to it, I don't think, the entire time I was in the hospital any of these times. But having that CD physically at my bedside, it was just a comfort to me. I had pictures of my kids on my laptop and on my phone. I had some books there that I, you know, would pick up and read passages at times. I always had music that brought me comfort. I had my whole Beatles catalog, you know, on my phone and in my laptop, so I could just at times sit back and chill out and just kind of shut the world out and enjoy that small thing. Important to surround yourself with beauty as much as you can in that hospital space and remind yourself of the life that you have in the world outside. So that segues into the next thing I think is important, that's so important, is to stay connected with the outside world. Delirium comes about many times because we tend to start thinking of this space that we're in as the world. Like, this is the world, and we forget there's a world out there. There's people out there that love us and that care about us. And so if you're not connected to them during this time, I think that can be very damaging. It's important through Zoom meetings, Skype, chat, phone calls, whatever it is, to stay connected to people. Whether you're initiating the calls, whether you're setting up times, specific times to interact with them, I think it's so important to do that and to be in touch with them. That brings me to a big issue that I probably sound like, oh yeah, this guy's a computer nerd. I think it's so important for you to have some type of, other than just a phone, either a mobile device or a laptop while you're in the hospital. You've got a chair, you've got a tray that pulls up to it. It's a natural like laptop stand. That was for me, my window to the outside world. And for some people, it's intimidating because I don't know how to use the internet very well, or I'm not a computer geek. Let me just say you don't have to be. If you get a laptop, you can get a nurse to take you to youtube.com and watch tutorial videos for how to do all these other things. You can private message me. I will help you learn how to do all these other things. But it's great to be able to video chat with your loved ones. It is great to be able to go online and find other people in the same situation you are in to talk and compare notes and empathize with them. Because you may not find that on your hospital unit. If you're an organ transplant candidate, you may be the only one that's on the unit that's in that situation sometimes. Not always, but that happens. So being able to interact with people in a similar situation and have a little bit of camaraderie there, it's very, very helpful. There's a lot of great groups on Facebook and Instagram and other places that can be so supportive and so helpful in terms of helping you get through these hospital stays. The laptop is a way to kind of escape too. I played a lot of games. I was able to, rather than being beholden to whatever was on TV at the time with the clicker, I could go look up certain things that I wanted to watch at the time, whatever the mood was that I was in. I could find something suited to that. I had access to music that way. There's just so many things you can do on there. One of the great things I discovered on there, which is another thing I would say is so important in a hospital environment, with all the busyness, the in and out, and people in taking blood and looking at your toes and looking at your eyeballs and all the stuff that goes on. You guys know you're interrupted constantly, right? Is to be able to have a moment, whatever you can find in the day where there's a lull, that you can just sit and be quiet and meditate. I discovered a program called Headspace when I was online, and it's just a meditation program. It's not real hippy dippy or new agey or anything like that. But it just basically taught me how to sit with my thoughts and be at peace and be still for a couple of minutes every day. And it kind of reminds, it's just a moment to remind yourself that of who you are in the middle of all this, that you're not a patient, you're not your sickness, that you're a person. You're an individual, you're unique, and you know, who am I outside of all this? Just having that moment with yourself. There are people that do that through prayer, there are people that do that through meditation, whatever it is, but I think that's an important thing to do on a daily basis, because you got plenty of time. Why not do it? You say, oh, I've always meant to look into meditation, or I've always meant to pray, but I don't know how to pray. Now's the time, man. You got all kinds of time on your hand. Figure it out now. There's all kinds of instructions, though, online, if you can get online. I think it's so important. I blogged while I was in the hospital because I realized I'm experiencing things that most people will not. I'm having a lot of thoughts and emotions that most people don't understand. And there are going to be others coming behind me that are going to be going through the same thing. And I would have loved to have had somewhere to go and say, hey, here's somebody who was in the hospital waiting for a heart transplant. What did they go through? What was their experience? I couldn't find much on that. It's one of the reasons I'm doing this podcast, because there's not a lot of patient perspective information out there that's not just clinical and medical, as I stated at the outset. So blogging for me became really important. It kept my family and friends kind of keyed into what was going on with me clinically, but also just my emotional state, my mental state. And hopefully, you know, it's there. It helps people down the road. I ended up turning it into a book that's, you know, not been a huge success, but the people around me have read it and they go, man, I didn't know half of this stuff. I would have never imagined. But now there's kind of some, I can have conversations with them about my experience living on an ICU. And so it's been valuable in that sense. I would just say whatever it is that you can do to help pass the time, don't just sit and watch television. That's probably the most poisonous thing you could do. All of this is really kind of taking control of your environment as much as you can when you can. I adopted street clothes because I knew that nothing, you know, I was not having people do EKGs on me every 5 minutes. I was just living there. I was waiting, basically. We did vital signs every day, maybe a blood draw through the PICC line, and then I had some dressing changes and stuff. So it was very easy for me to wear sweats or shorts and a shirt, something I learned from Perry. First time I saw him, he was wearing an Ohio, I don't even know the name of the team. I'm not a sports guy, but he was wearing it's a college basketball team, football team. Sorry, Perry, I don't remember. But he was wearing the sports jersey and a pair of shorts walking around. I thought, man, isn't that the life to be on an ICU and wear clothes you're comfortable in? Why can't I do that? I'd been in there enough, and my situation was such that I was able to do that. Maybe you're not, but if you can, you know, it's some laundry work for your loved one who's back and forth to the hospital, probably. But if you can do that, it's great. Just having a little bit of control. It's amazing to get up in the morning and go, hey, I get to choose what I'm wearing today. I don't get to choose my disease. I don't get to choose where I am on the waiting list. I don't get to choose what medications I have to take or my nurse or any other thing that's going to happen today, but I can pick what I wear. There's some power in that. And you need as much of that as you can get at this point in time. We did a lot of research into the hospital protocols for what you could and could not have in the room. Open flames, obviously not. Anything that was coiled, heating elements, no way. But I was in a real bind because I literally could not sometimes swallow the hospital food. It was so terrible. I'm a foodie. I'm a food snob. I love to cook, and I'm not picky. I will eat anything, but it needs to be good. It needs to taste good. It needs to be, you know, at least healthy and prepared in a way that there's some nutritional value. And the hospital I was in, unfortunately, their method of staying within guidelines was to serve very unhealthy food in small portions so that they were staying under the sodium levels and but you ended up hungry all the time. And hospital staff, your doctor's office, many people don't realize this, but most hospitals, that the food services are contracted out to people that really have no kind of stock or experience in healthy eating. And so you've got nutritionists. I was in this weird situation where nutritionists were coming in telling me I need to eat a certain way, and then the tray would show up, and I'm like, this is the opposite of what I was just told. I have no, what am I supposed to do? Probably need to spend a whole episode on that, talking about food in the hospital. Some places are great. I've been at Stanford University, not Stanford, but you know, I would rather eat there than a lot of 4-star restaurants I've been to. It was so good. But my place, I think they were getting the food out of a dumpster or something. It was awful. So I found ways to get around that by keeping a travel cooler refrigerator type device that I ordered from Amazon. I kept that in the room. I plugged it into, it was a cigarette lighter that went in, a plug that went into an adapter and into the wall. No coils, no open flame, nothing that was dangerous. And I was able to keep some things in there that I could eat when I wanted to eat. Obviously, staying within the guidelines that my doctors had given me as a cardiac patient. So that was one thing. I ended up actually ordering a induction burner, which uses magnetic heat. So there's no open flame, no heating element, no danger of fire or smoke alarm or anything else. And I bought a couple of pots and pans that went with that so that I could cook little meals when I wanted to. I got a little camping convection oven that plugged into the wall. It blows hot air. So none of this violated hospital policy. Now, I'm going to say no one was happy about it when they saw those things, but technically they couldn't say you're not allowed to have those. Perry had done this before me in some ways. And so I saw that he had done it, gotten away with it. He was living there for an extended period of time. I knew I was going to be there for an extended period of time. So I basically set up this little area in my room out of the way of anything the doctors or nurses were going to need to do. And I ordered food. My wife brought me food. I ordered food through Shipt and Peapod and some of these delivery services. It was really weird for everybody because they were delivering to a hospital room, but there's a way to do it. So I just you know, through Amazon and those services, I set up a situation where if I don't like what comes on the tray, or if my sodium's going up because I'm eating this garbage, I can cook my own food. That's pretty extreme. So I know a lot of people that's not going to apply, but I'm just giving you that as an example of some things you can do to control your environment, control what you can when you can. The other thing I would say in terms of controlling your environment, when you're on an ICU, your vital signs, typically I think they're Q2 or Q4. So you've got people coming in your room all hours of the night, right? You've got, I was in a teaching hospital where the student doctors were supposed to come in at 5:30 in the morning every morning to ask you how you were doing and assess you and all that. And then they're going to report back to the doctor. Well, after about 2 weeks of that, you can imagine it got really old because I was not sleeping. And you know this if you've been in a hospital. You can't get sleep in a hospital. But when you look at that situation, if you've been in for a weekend or 3 or 4 days, you think, God, I'm exhausted because they don't let you sleep. Extrapolate that out to months at a time or weeks at a time. You got to put your foot down somewhere. And I would, maybe your unit won't let you do this, but I was in a situation where after a couple of weeks, I said, look, guys, my vital signs have been the same every day. Blood labs are the same every day. Why in the world are we checking these every 2 hours? Because I was there optionally. I opted to come in and live in the hospital. I could have been at home. I could have said, I'm not staying here. But I opted to stay there and wait for a heart. I said, if I was at home, I would be checking my vitals every day. Right? That's it. I would be getting a blood draw 3 times a week, not every day. So what can we do here to make this where I'm not going to go crazy over the long term because I'm getting woken up every 2 hours of being assessed every morning. My situation does not change day to day. I'm not in heart failure anymore. I'm on an artificial heart. Now, if you are most people are not in this situation and you do need to be assessed every day, but either you've got to change your sleeping schedule to where it's okay to get woken up at 5:30 in the morning or see if they can assess you later. You need to ask about these things. This is self-advocacy, right? Because if you're not sleeping, you are not at your best. You're not going to make good decisions and you're not healthy. If you don't sleep good, your health is not good. So at a point, I had to put my foot down and say, no, I've got to have at least 6 hours of sleep uninterrupted. So between midnight and 6 o'clock, I don't want anybody in this room, you know? And keeping in mind that as a patient, you are allowed to refuse anything that's being done, whether it's a blood draw, test, labs, having your temperature taken, you can say, no, I don't want to do that. So that's part of self-advocacy. And I had to say, I'm going to be here for a long time. I can't have somebody in my room waking me up at 5:30 every morning after someone was there at 3:30. And they're at 1:30 and they're at 11:30. You can't wake me up all night and then come in and turn the lights on at 5:30 and then expect me to stay in the situation for, you know, however many months. It could have been a year for all I knew. So that was the agreement that I was able to come to was nobody in the room between 12 and 8. I don't need to be assessed. If something's wrong, I will tell you because I'm otherwise healthy. But again, that was my unique situation. If there's a way you can be assessed later in the day, or you can go to bed earlier at night and say, look, I'm going to go to bed at 10 every night. And that from that point forward, I don't want anybody in there unless I call you until 5:30. Or if you want to check on me once in the middle of the night, but try not to wake me up. You got to get sleep, you know? And so there's a balance there. They need to know what's going on with you. It's dangerous for them to leave you alone for a long time, but you also have to get sleep. So you got to figure out some way to negotiate with the staff as to how that's going to happen if you're there long term. For a weekend, you're just going to have to deal with it. But long term, there ought to be some, it's kind of a mitigating circumstance that you can say, hey, look, this is crazy. And I'm delirious because I haven't had sleep. That also contributes to ICU delirium, by the way. So be aware of that. Don't be rude about it. Advocate for yourself. Do the best you can in the situation. But that is part of surviving a long hospital stay is having a little bit of control over some of those things. Thanks for listening. And if you're in the hospital right now, man, just hang in there. I know it's such a cliche thing to say, but avail yourself of what you can to try to get through the thing. It's not going to last forever. But you don't want to go crazy in the interim. So hopefully some of this stuff has been helpful for you. We'll see you next time. Thanks for listening.